Hi friends, welcome to Book Talk. Friends, in today's world you have lakhs and lakhs of books and in various languages by various authors in many countries, and it's practically impossible to zoom past all these books, and that's how we've started this particular program, which gives you a short flavor of the book and tells you what the book is all about. And if you want to read the book, you can pick it up later. And in this context, taking this mission forward, I have brought this book, this short story, in fact, Three Questions by Leo Tolstoy. Now, Leo Tolstoy was a Russian author who had written that famous book, War and Peace. So friends, it once occurred to a certain king that if he always knew the right time to begin everything, if he knew who are the right people to listen to and whom to avoid, and above all, if he always knew what was the most important thing to do, he would never fail in life. And then if he took up any project, he would be successful in that. So keeping this in mind, he announced in his kingdom that any person who could teach him what was the right time, what is the right time for every action, he would reward him very handsomely. So many people came to him with lots of suggestions, and some said that you must form an advanced timetable which should have days, months, years, and you should strictly move according to that. Some said you should have a council of ministers who should keep advising you every now and then. Some even gave a weird suggestion that you should hire some magicians who are very good at telling you all this. So with all this, the king was going nowhere. So he gave no reward to anybody, and he asked them to go. But still he was quite determined to find out the answer to his questions. So he decided to go to a hermit who used to stay in the woods, but he wasn't very far off. But he knew that the hermit is a very strict kind of a person, and he doesn't entertain VIPs, and he only meets common people. So before going there, he changed his costume, he dismounted from his horse, and even left his bodyguard behind, and now he was alone. And then he started walking up to the hermit. When the king approached the hermit, he was digging the ground in front of his hut. Upon seeing the king, he greeted him, but he kept digging. The hermit was really looking frail and weak. Each time he struck the spade on the ground and turned a little earth, he went breathless. So on account of which the king could make out that he is very, very weak. The king went up to him and said, "I have come to you, wise man, to ask you to answer three questions. One, how can I learn to do the right thing at the right time? Two, who are the people I need the most, and whom should I therefore pay more attention than the rest? Three, and what affairs are the most important and need my attention on priority?" The hermit heard the king, but answered nothing. He just spat on his hand and recommenced his digging. "You are tired," said the king, "so therefore let me do some work for you. Give me the spade." "Thanks," said the hermit, and he gave him the spade, and the king started working, and the hermit sat on the ground. When the king had dug about two beds, he couldn't resist. He again asked that, "Wise man, I've come to ask for some answers to my questions. Will you be kind enough to tell me?" And in the meanwhile, the hermit just got up and he started stretching his hands, and he told the king that, "Now you must be tired, so give me the spade. I'll do some work." But the king did not give him the spade and continued to dig. An hour had passed, and then another hour, and the sun began to set behind the trees, and the king at last struck spade onto the ground and said, Sir, I came to you for an answer to my questions. If you can't give me those answers, please tell me. I will return home. But suddenly, the hermit started shouting, "Look at that! Someone is running towards us!" Said he. He yelled, "Let's see who it is." So, upon this shout of the hermit, the king was extremely surprised, and he turned around and saw a bearded man running out of the forest and towards them. The man held his hands pressed against his stomach, and he was profusely bleeding. And by the time he came up to the king and the hermit, he collapsed, and he started moaning very feebly, and the blood was oozing out. So the king, realizing that the hermit is very weak, he took out his hanky and took a towel from the hermit and pressed it against the wound. Then he started bandaging the wound. Then he got some more bandage from somewhere, and he again applied it on the wound. And meanwhile, this guy was moaning with pain, and gradually the bleeding stopped. When this fellow, he asked for some water, and the king ran and got him some water. And finally, when he was a little better, the king, with the help of the frail hermit, carried him inside the hut where he could rest. While lying on the bed, the man closed his eyes and was quiet for some time, but the king was extremely tired from the long, tiresome day that he had spent. So he crouched on the threshold and fell asleep, and slept all throughout the short summer night. When he awoke in the morning, he could not immediately connect himself to the surroundings, and also he could not connect himself with the stranger, the bearded man, lying on the bed, and was intently gazing at him with his glistening eyes. "Forgive me," said the bearded man in a weak voice, when he saw the king was awake and was looking at him. "I don't know you and have nothing to forgive you for," said the king. "You don't know me, but I know you. I am an enemy of yours who had sworn to take revenge because you had killed my brother, and rather you had executed him, and you had even confiscated my property. I knew you had gone to see the hermit." Friends, let me also tell you, hermit means a very knowledgeable person or a sage or a sadhu. I didn't tell you earlier, for which I am very sorry. So, he said that, "I knew you had gone to meet the hermit alone, so I had planned to kill you on your way back. But the day passed and you never came back, and so I came out of my ambush, and I was wanting to come to you and kill you, but then I bumped into one of your bodyguards, and he unfortunately recognized me and he attacked me, and so I got wounded. I escaped from him, but would have bled to death, but you were the person who dressed my wounds, because of which I got saved, and you did a very meticulous job. I wish to kill you, but you have saved me, Your Majesty. So, if you wish, and if I survive, I am going to be the most faithful slave of yours, and I would even tell my children to become the same. Please forgive me, sir." The king was extremely happy on this, because he was able to befriend an enemy, and that easily, or that or in a very difficult manner, he didn't know, but he was extremely happy that he was able to befriend a long-term enemy. So he not only forgave him, but he even promised the bearded man that he would send his servants to look after him. He would even send his physician to give him medicines and take care of his wounds, and he also promised that he would restore his property. The king then went out and looked around for the hermit. Before leaving, he wished to beg once more for an answer to his questions. The hermit was outside on his knees and he was sowing seeds in the beds that had been dug the day before. King approached him and said, "For the last time I pray to you to answer my questions, wise man." "You have already been answered," said the hermit, still crouching on his thin legs and looking up at the king who stood before him. "Answered? But how? What do you know? Or what do you mean, sorry?" asked the king. "Don't you see?" replied the hermit. "If you had not pitied on my weakness yesterday and had not dug three beds for me and had gone your way, that man would have attacked you and you would have been injured. And because of that, you would have repented not having stayed back with me." So the most important time was when you were digging those beds, and I was the most important man for you, and to do me good was your most important business. Afterwards, the man ran to us, injured. The most important time was when you were attending to his wounds. For if you had not nursed his wounds, he would have died without making peace with you. So that was the most important time. So he was the most important man also, and what you did for him was your most important business. Remember, my friend, there is only one time that is important, and that time is now. Friends, we all keep talking about future, past, but the reality is the time that you have now. It is the most important time because it is the only time when you have any kind of power. You don't have any power when it comes to your past. You cannot change it. You don't have any control over the future. So the only time that you have in your life is today, just now. The most necessary person is the one with whom you are. For no man knows whether he will ever have dealings with anyone else. And the most important business, friends, is to do that person good, because for that alone, man was sent into this life. So with this, we end this very beautiful story with a very strong parable. And friends, we all, as human beings, think we are very powerful, we are very strong, and we know everything. But in reality, things are very different. It is almost the reverse of what we think. And friends, if you've liked this beautiful story of Leo Tolstoy, kindly share it, spread the message, and soon we'll come out with another story for you. Also, subscribe to our channel. And with that, goodbye from Book Talk.